Over millions of years, the invertebrate immune system has evolved through a long-term negative relationship between two species. This takes the form of parasitism, where one species, the parasite, benefits at the expense of the other species, the host. Just how infectious this parasite is depends on its virulence. In other words, its ability to infect the host with fatal consequence. Over evolutionary time, this virulence has been fine-tuned by the parasites so that the rate of infection has become optimised.
The optimisation of parasitic virulence is desirable, as a more restrained pathogen may lose out competitively with a more aggressive one when infecting the same host. However, an increase in parasite virulence may well mean more rapid host death. This could then incur a disadvantage to the parasite if it is unable to transmit to a new host before the demise of its original host organism. This then demonstrates that a point of equilibrium exists in parasitic virulence, a point where parasites are virulent enough to invade their host tissues easily, but not so virulent as to rapidly kill their hosts before transmission. This is a point of maximum parasite fitness as well as optimal virulence.
We can illustrate this equilibrium point with a basic graph. So as you can see, as virulence increases, so does parasite fitness, up until this point of equilibrium, after which any increase in virulence of the pathogen results in decreased fitness due to an increased rate of host death under parasitic strain.
The main benefits of increased virulence is a higher transmission rate. By extracting more resources from the host, the parasite is able to make more transmissible forms per unit time. Another benefit is slower parasite clearance rate, and hence a longer infection from which to transmit. However, the cost of virulence is premature host death, which shortens the lifetime of the infection. Thus, there is a trade-off between how fast and how long the parasite transmits. This leads to maximum lifetime transmission occurring in parasites that have intermediate virulence, and this is therefore the outcome of natural selection. This has become known as the trade-off hypothesis. Now, direct evidence for a positive relationship between transmission rate and virulence among natural pathogens has been observed in a number of different studies.
This charming creature is Daphnia magna, a water flea. It and its natural parasite, Pasturia ramosa, have been the subject of a study which provided empirical evidence to support this theory.
Over a period of 140 days, the first infected Daphnia death took place at day 23. And 10 out of the 39 infected hosts died before the bacterial transmission spores were produced. This is a large chunk of infected hosts, amongst that about 25% of the parasite transmission potential. Hastily killing off the host is damaging to the parasite, as it does not produce its transmission spores until several weeks later.
Hosts that died at about day 60 contained the greatest number of parasitic spores, and those that died before or after this period contained the least. This is an advantage to the parasite, as it can utilise the host resources to maximise its spore production. It also provides evidence that its virulence is tuned as it infects the host at intermediate levels. Not so early that no spore production occurs, and not too late that the host has become an insufficient source of resources.
Parasites are dependent on their host organisms, for both survival as well as transmission opportunities. So it follows logically that parasites may evolve to become more benign to their host organisms over evolutionary time. However, in 2007, Rudy et al. Studied the effect of a protozoan parasitic infection in monarch butterflies. In this study, the authors found a positive relationship between the level of parasite replication occurring within the host and the degree of virulence and rate of transmission in the parasites. This shows that natural selection for transmission in parasites can favour genomes that may confer harmful consequences on their host organisms. So just like in Daphnia, fitness of parasites is maximised at an intermediate level of replication, a level beyond which the detriments of heightened host mortality would surpass the benefits of a greater transmission rate in the parasites.
Optimal virulence is not solely determined by the parasite, however, and host susceptibility also plays a large role in determining a pathogen's infectious success. So, within a host, infection must first become established, and in order to repel this attack, the host immune system must elicit a number of countermeasures in order to combat this. Now, the competency of the host immune system is determined by a number of different factors, and the immune system itself can actually be weakened through factors such as poor nutrition, increased levels of stress, or reduced levels of hygiene or sanitation. So this immune deficiency as a whole within the host, or how well it can defend itself from attack by a pathogen, also plays a vital role in determining a parasite's virulence. So according to a study published by Kovar et al., virulence has been shown to increase with horizontal transmission. This is transmission between non-relatives in a population when compared with vertical transmission, which is transmission from parent down to offspring. Another potential factor occurs in the instance of multiple infections within a single host. This leads to increased competitions between pathogens as the host is able to survive if it can resist the most virulent strain. So the low virulence strategy that we have mentioned becomes less advantageous and confers an advantage to the highly virulent strategy. This shows that there's not one unilateral factor which determines optimal virulence, but that multiple determinants of optimal virulence give rise to a whole spectrum of severity of infectious disease.